What's up, party people? Casey here. How are you? Welcome to another installment of Tedious and Inaccessible, the incredibly difficult cooking show that's actually a lot easier than you think. So this request that we're going to execute on tonight comes from two really good friends of mine, Larry and Markus, from the Upper West Side, New York. Oh, people are cringing behind the camera. Larry and Markus are from the Upper West Side, New York, the epicenter of the crisis at the moment. And two amazing friends of mine, Larry I've known longer than my wife, about 21 years, hands down one of the most hilarious 14-year-old joke exchanging absurd humans. I don't need to call him absurd as much as myself. And I love Larry and his husband, Markus, who is an amazing human as well, an incredibly refined, artistic human being whose cooking skills easily outmatch my own. So I'm making this in large part because Markus and Larry 100 years ago, and Markus really liked it and still talks about it. And all you need to do is let me know a compliment and I'll just repeat the behavior. So this one goes out to Larry and Markus. I hope you guys are both well. I know that they're doing well, but I hope to see you guys again really soon. And this one goes out to you. So this is the one. Tell your friends. We're gonna do lemon gnocchi with a light cream sauce. And the treatment of it, this is going to be an appetizer rather than either kind of the main entree, or even this is something you could do as a second course. There are lots of different ways that you can treat this, but I'm gonna do it just as an appetizer. So let's get started. I think I'm learning as I go here when I make these videos that I don't think it's a particularly productive use of time to talk about every ingredient and how much of it we're gonna use, other than to highlight what the ingredients are very quickly and let you know there's either something that's kind of exotic or not. For the gnocchi, we've got Parmesan Reggiano, potatoes, chives, lemons, eggs, flour, cream, butter, et cetera, et cetera. So the recipe will be in the link. And so it's really straightforward. Nothing really outside the realm of normal ingredients. Go. I think it's a better use of time to talk about the specialty equipment and tools that I'm gonna use. You can quickly figure out, hey, I don't have that. Can I bum it down the street from Gertrude and execute on this recipe? So let's do this really quickly. I like to use a microplane, not wholly necessary, but I like it quite a bit better than a box cutter for the cheese, and I'll explain why later. Standard peeler for the potatoes, a spider catching device, I can't remember what it's called. Not necessary, just anything that kind of scoops the dumplings out of the water, but I like this spider web design. And probably the most specialty piece of equipment is this ricer, which probably many of you have, but if you don't, you're going to need this. Because we're gonna cook the potatoes through and get them through the ricer. I don't know if you can look through there real quick. See all those holes? They do a really, really good job of eliminating lumps when we put the potato through and jam that through in order to make our dough. I should mention quickly, if you don't already know, that a gnocchi is very pasta-like in nature, but it's actually a potato dumpling, and we're gonna make those. I like to go two different ways with my gnocchi. One is very soft and pillow-like and kind of melts in your mouth. And the other has a lot more density and chew and crisp on it. So this version is going to be the super light pillowy version. And we're going to get started now. All right, so we're going to get started on our mise en place, or our prep for the meal here. Fortunately, it's a very low maintenance prep mise en place process we're going to go through. We're just going to peel some potatoes. We're gonna zest two lemons, and we're gonna chop our chives to the tune of, say, 2 or 3 tablespoons. So, I don't know if you guys have ever peeled a potato before. I don't think anyone has, but it looks like this. Okay, so a quick note on the potatoes. These are Idaho or Baker's potatoes. Peeled them, cut them in roughly 1/2-inch cubes. We're gonna get in a large pot. We're gonna cover them by 2 or 3 inches over their heads in cold water. And then we're gonna get them on the stovetop. Make sure to put your lid on top to get the heat going faster, and let those go 15, 20 minutes. Check them as you go until they are cooked through. Okay, continuing the prep for the gnocchi, we're gonna zest some lemons the zest of two lemons, not three. You'll need your microplane to do that job. Obviously, be sure that you are cleaning all your fruits and vegetables and hosing them down with some kind of spray wash with all things COVID these days. So I don't do much than just sort of lean it at an angle over my cutting board and roll away from me. So I'm just going through and rolling away from me. I get to the pith and I stop. Do not go deeper and deeper into this because that is very bitter. So once that area is covered, move on to the next part. And you just move around that lemon until you hit that white pith, and that's it. Okay, so we're wrapping up our prep here for the gnocchi, and we're gonna chop some chives wildly uncomplicated. We're just gonna take our chef's knife and run them through. I like nice thin chives. Nothing thick or slanted in this case. Sometimes I do them on the bias, but in this case, I just want a pile of 2 to 3 tablespoons of finely chopped chives. Okay, so we've got our, I forgot to mention, that was 1 pound of baker's potatoes, or Idaho potatoes, and we had them cubed, and they are boiled through. The one extra step that I want to mention here is they go back in the pot. And the heat goes on probably in the neighborhood of medium high. So I'll go in there. All I want to make sure I'm doing is drying them out because we want dry potatoes. So two quick notes, get them in the pot, get them dried out, but also be very careful about scorching the bottom and turning the potatoes brown because we want white potatoes for the gnocchi. Okay, so our potatoes are almost ready, or they're ready, but we want to prepare the liquid mixture that's going to go on top of the flour and the potatoes. So let's do that real quick. In this bowl, we're going to separate our eggs into just the egg yolks. It's going to be super wasteful and get rid of the egg whites. I always do this with my fingers. A lot of people like to do the old back and forth between the two eggshells, and it just seems like such a waste of time to me. It's very easy to separate that egg yolk from the whites and just get it in there. That one was a little sloppy, but let's see if I can improve my record here. Just tend to grab that egg yolk and let the whites fall into the sink. That's much better. All right, so we have 3 egg yolks there. And 3 egg yolks and our 2 lemons worth of zest. Turn it down a little bit, a healthy pinch of salt. And then we're going to do just a tablespoon of olive oil. There we go. And that is going to be the liquid mixture that we pour over the top of the drained and dried potatoes and the flour that we put into it. There you go. And really, kind of the point of this is, and one of the most important things that can happen is make sure that the lemon zest is well mixed around so you don't wind up with a giant clump in different parts of the dough. Okay, so this is an important segment because we're actually going to make dough right now. We're gonna take our ricer, remember this? And, I use my countertop, this old dated, marble, whatever it is. As a surface, you can use a cutting board, you can use a plastic board, all are acceptable, but I like a nice white space. And I'm just gonna start to grab scoopfuls of my potato, my cooked and dried out potato, and get them into the compartment here. You see that, dude?
Yep.
All right. And then make sure that that little hammer part goes on top. And all I'm looking to do, I'm gonna jam this through, but I'm gonna try to create an even layer. I just have a pound of potatoes, so we don't need to go nuts in terms of the surface area. We just want to make sure that we're getting it covered. Nothing too big. I'll grab that guy, slip that to the side. I'll do one more example and then we'll cut to the next part. These potatoes look pretty perfect just in terms of them being very dry. I like that a lot. I want the moisture to come from the other wet ingredients, not from water on the potatoes. That's a good amount. Just want to cover an area and make sure that we don't have a lot of blank spots in there. Okay, so we've riced our potatoes what we care most about is just creating a nice even layer in our rectangle. And then I've got 3/4 cup of all-purpose flour that I'm gonna sprinkle throughout here. Hey, Fido, turn that movie down, would you, bud? Thank you. So it's not just a potato dough, it is definitely a potato flour dough. Cover all my areas here. And that'll do. And finally, where's my spoon? We're gonna get our wet ingredients and try to get them evenly distributed through this Central Park rectangle. And again, that was lemon zest and olive oil and egg yolk. So there you have all the ingredients for dough, right? You got some flour or other elements that can turn somewhat glutinous. And now we're just gonna mix them together. I'm just gonna flip them over with my dough cutter a little bit. And then ultimately I'm gonna start to push them into a ball. Use my hands here. Get the wet and dry together. You notice I'm very loose out of the gate here. I'm not trying to jam it together and smash it down very hard. I really just want the wet and dry to come together as best they can without creating pockets of too much wet or pockets of too much dry.
Just let them come together naturally.
Oh, well, thank you. Well said, Dylan. That's exactly right. That is exactly right. And honestly, it's crazy, but I can smell lemon coming off of this beautiful ball of dough already, which is pretty awesome. And I just tend to use my dough cutter to get all the goodness off the bottom of the counter so I don't lose anything. I hate wasting the dough when we go to this effort. Let's get it all, right? Even the dough in my hands. I like to try to get off as best I can, but I try not to worry about that too much because the bottom line is, if you work this dough too much, it becomes very glutinous and dense, and that's not what we're after at all. That tends to be more in the area of like a ramen noodle, but we just want something kind of light and fluffy going. So I feel like that's pretty well incorporated. I may fold it over itself a little bit, just a couple of times, because I can see spots of white and darker yellow. But again, my goal is to just not go nuts and beat the hell out of this dough so it's super chewy and glutinous. Okay, so this is actually going to be our working space to create the gnocchi themselves. So we've got our beautiful ball of dough here. It's feeling really good. A little damp on the outside. I probably don't need all of it. So I'm gonna take my dough cutter and just cut it in half. You notice I dusted the surface with some all-purpose flour because I want this to become, you know, a space that where the dough can take up a little bit of that flour and be a little easier to handle and move around. By the way, I mentioned this dough cutter is, I didn't mention it as a specialty equipment because it's wildly unimportant. A knife does the same job. All right, so all I'm gonna do is take half this dough and start to move it around. And I think we've all done something similar to this with Play-Doh. This might even be too much, we'll see. But I'm basically going to try to gently roll it through the flour and get it down as evenly as I can to about a half an inch of dough. There we go. More flour. I'm just trying to get this sort of Play-Doh log, if you will. And I think I'm gonna kill this, I'm gonna cut this now. This is becoming a little unmanageable in its length. So this might be better to manage because I can, again, all I'm looking for is consistency. So you can see I keep going back to the thinnest part and thickening it up a little bit, and then going back to the thicker part and doing a roll on it. I just want consistency in terms of my eyeballing a half inch rope of gnocchi dough. Okay, so I'm not gonna lie. I did a practice round, look at those. They look pretty good, but I wanted to kind of test if I am as good as I used to be when I did this a lot before. So I've got a pretty good half inch rope of dough going here. I think that's good. I'll give you a little tip here. I think consistency is everything when it comes to the technique of this. So for instance, I'm gonna take my my dough cutter and cut inch dumplings across. And you know, some of those are inches and some of those are not inches. So the more you can be consistent, the better you're gonna be at this. And I'm not perfect. So I'm gonna try to eyeball this into an inch and move through those and hope that they are all predominantly the same length. Knowing that the world is in a perfect place. So, there are my dumplings. I'm gonna try to put them back into kind of rope form. I can already tell this guy's super small compared to, thank you, go away. Now here's the trick. So I'm gonna take my dumpling and I'm gonna take the back of a fork and I'm gonna place my dumpling lengthwise right in the middle of the back of that fork. And I'm gonna push it into the back of the fork and roll it toward the end of the fork. All the while trying to maintain its length. And boom. So this is what we wind up with. And that's a little misshapen, so I'm gonna shape that guy down and get it back into that. So what we are ultimately trying to accomplish here, obviously, are these ridges in the gnocchi, because they'll cook that way and they'll hold sauce better. So I'll do one more for you guys and then let you try on your own. Back of the fork, middle of the fork, some pressure down while I'm rolling forward, trying to maintain the length, and boom. And I probably push it back into the shape I wanted to be at the end, and boom. Okay, so we have the majority of our dough has been turned into little gnocchis, which is pretty exciting. A little bit of dust of flour on a cookie sheet just so they're manageable. Let's do this real quickly. Where's my salt? Help me. We've got a big pot full of water, maybe the quarter of which is left unfilled. I have something to say about this. People are gonna tell you that the water for pasta, even gnocchi, should be, you know, the flavor of the ocean, which is an intense, high salinity, intense salty flavor. I don't agree with that, in the sense that when you're dealing with fresh pasta or a fresh gnocchi dough, and you dump as much salt in as you can to get for the taste of the ocean, it really oversalts it. So I'm gonna say for a pot this size and this much water, I'm probably doing about a half cup to three quarters of a cup. Now that's quite a bit, right? But it is gonna flavor the dough, but when you go crazy with like a couple of cups of salt, I find it's just way too much. Totally absurd. All right, the gnocchis are ready. The water is ready. So let's make our cream sauce so that's ready to go. We can finally get this thing together. So smaller saucepan. I'm gonna take a full cup of whole milk and get it in there. I'm gonna get it on the back burner. Oops, that's on the back burner. Come on, you can do it. Here we go. On kind of a medium low. I want that milk to be hot, not scorched, not boiling over, but we want it to be hot. That's really important. And then we're gonna take our bigger, this is where the saucepan is. The sauce is ultimately gonna be built. And so let's turn up the heat there to about medium, probably like a medium, right? Not a medium low, not a medium high, medium. And we're gonna get our 2 tablespoons of butter in there. Let me stick your camera in there, Dylan, that's a good idea. So we're gonna let that butter melt and get just a little bit of bubbly, and we'll show you what happened. And Dylan, see that? That's bubbling fat, in this case, butter. 2 tablespoons of bubbly butter. That's exactly where you want it to be. And then we're gonna create a roux. A roux is equal parts fat and flour. And that means that's 2 tablespoons of what, Dylan? All-purpose flour. Boom. Now, I wanna get a whisk immediately and get it moving around. Look how quickly it clumps together. And that's perfect. Now, I'm gonna be very cautious. And I'm gonna move this around. We wanna cook this off for about 2 minutes to avoid the floury taste. It burns off after a couple minutes. But I am also gonna be super cautious about
this roux turning brown. There are tons of recipes where brown roux is a great thing. This is not one of them, because ultimately I want a roux in a very kind of light color as well as a light taste in it. So I'm gonna continue to stir this like mad. I'm actually gonna crank up the heat on my back burner to get my milk nice and hot, because that's the next step, is to add our milk. So take it off, the burner is needed, and move it around. You don't have to be married to keeping this right on the flame. This is great, I don't have any brown color at all, which is awesome. Okay, I'm gonna take a little bit of a gamble and say we've got enough heat on that milk. What we didn't want is cold milk, or car from that, so check it out. Here we go. I'm gonna pour that milk in and whisk at the same time. Got a good shot, D? Get to the bottom of the pan. See how cool that is? See how it's so willing and able to clump immediately? Check it out though. See how they clump so quickly? Mm-hmm. That's pretty cool. And then I'm whisking and whisking. Trying to make sure there are no lumps in there. We're integrating all that milk in with the butter flour mixture, otherwise known as a roux. Get to the bottom of the pan. See how it's still like oatmeal in there? That's actually a cool thing. We're gonna dump the rest of that milk in. Okay, so we're just gonna get this on the heat. Thank you, Dylan. We're just gonna get this on the heat and give it probably a full 5 minutes to thicken a little bit. And then we'll season it in just a minute. Now we're gonna do a couple things. We're gonna thin it out a bit and season it. So we're gonna go back in the pan, D. In the pan. Generous pinch of salt. I'm gonna go do this for the sake of saving, because it's gonna be dry. This is a quarter cup of dry white wine. And I'm immediately gonna whisk that in and make sure that it gets incorporated well. Check it out in the pan, D. There we go. And we'll let that alcohol burn off a little bit. That's looking pretty good. Okay. We're gonna do a pretty healthy pinch of freshly grated nutmeg. Again, as I mentioned in one of the other videos, nutmeg and cream go really well together. And then a careful pinch of white pepper. White, because I want the color to remain light like it is. But be careful, because white pepper is quite a bit hotter. It's actually the center of a black peppercorn. And quite a bit hotter. So you don't wanna go nuts with that. You just wanna be careful. It's good for color, it's good for flavor, but you gotta be somewhat cautious about that. All right, so that is kind of my light cream sauce. For my taste, it's probably a little too thick, so I'm gonna set it aside while we work on the gnocchis, and I'll adjust the consistency a bit. All right, so we've made some adjustments on our cream sauce here. I threw in some dashes of white wine vinegar, more white pepper, more salt, and actually I went back to the well and put more cream in it. What I'm most interested in is obviously great flavor, but I also want a certain consistency. And for that, I needed it to be quite a bit thinner. All I really wanted to do was grab a spoon, but I still wanted to run like water off that spoon. And it's much, much better. So I'm gonna put that on the back heat and get into cooking some gnocchi.
So we have our water, we have our gnocchi. Let's make some magic. We are actually in the home stretch here. I'm just gonna grab these by hand and drop them in, two or three at a time. The cool thing about gnocchi, like a lot of fresh pasta, is it's very communicative with you. It lets you know when it's ready. So what's gonna happen is it's gonna sink to the bottom. And when it's cooked, it's going to float to the top. And you probably give it like another minute after it's on top. And then it's done. All right, come on in here, Dylan.
Check it out. Gnocchi. Telling us that they're all done and ready to go. So this is our spider strainer. It works pretty darn well to grab those guys. Give it a strain. Don't have to lose every drop of water or liquid, but we can get them in a giant bowl here and get everything out of that hot water pretty quickly. And I have to say, they're looking pretty damn delightful. Yep, that's it. That's a wrap. So,
just gonna put a little bit of olive oil on top of these guys so that they're manageable. When we're ready to plate, I'm gonna soak them. Not every little single piece has to be covered in olive oil, but just enough so they don't get stuck to our bowl and I can get them into the serving vehicle, if you will, when we're ready. All right, home stretch, who's that? Oh, hey, it's Finn, everybody.
Hello.
Home stretch, we're finally plating this thing. I noticed in my previous videos that I have really been phoning it in, half-assing my plating. So I'm gonna go ahead and step it up tonight. And again, this is meant to be an appetizer course. You could use it as a second course. You can use it as a main course. That's all up to you. But I'm gonna use this as an appetizer and I'm gonna step it up, ladies and gentlemen. So I'm gonna plate these gnocchi in little martini glasses. Lemon gnocchi. See if we can get enough going for everybody. Finn's clapping, and that makes me pretty happy. Pre-clapping is a good thing. Notice that little bit of olive oil really paid off big time. Makes these guys manageable in and out of the bowl and in the glass. Why not just go big, right, Finn?
Mm-hmm.
More gnocchi for everybody?
Totally.
What could be wrong with that? Cool. Let me think about this. Yes. So then we're going to move into our sauce. The sauce consistency is exactly where I want it to be. Pretty liquidy, but clean. And that is what we want here. Uh-oh. That's why I put that on that cutting board, so it could be a little bit sloppy. Lots of flavor, pretty thin. That's what I meant by a light sauce. I meant light in consistency. I wanted to cling to all the gnocchi, not be a heavy, heavy scene, but filled with flavor. And the drooling noise is a little gross. All right, so we've got our lemon gnocchi. God, that's good. We've got our light cream sauce. And let's go ahead and top that with chives. Finnegan, how do you feel about chives?
Not great.
So would you like one without chives?
Yes.
Okay. Just this once. Finn can escape the life of chives. And I'm going pretty heavy here, right? We don't have a lot of contrasting flavors, let's be clear. We've got doughy pasta, potato dough, excuse me. We've got a light cream. They kind of blend together, so I'm going heavy on the chives, and then let's make it rain with a cloud of light, fluffy Parmesan. Finnegan, drool much?
Yes.
On all of these. Oops, just lost that.
Delicious.
But that's why this microplane is great. Really thin strands of Parmesan. Really fantastic. All right, we're making a mess, but that's just fine. And then listen, this is a pretty decadent dish. It's rich in sauce, rich in pasta. So let's just stop fucking around. And let's go all the way. Let's go all the way. We've got a little bit of caviar. We're gonna top this with. Right on top. Finn, how do you feel about caviar?
Not great.
Not for you. So we'll skip you. And boom. All right. We've got little forks that are way too fussy and fancy, but they work great here. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, there you have it. Lemon gnocchi with a light cream sauce and some Parmesan and some chives and some caviar on top. By the way, quick note about caviar, you don't have to spend $1 billion on it. Just you find the lowest price point and go up a couple steps, you're in good shape. All right, so most importantly, I hope you, Larry and Markus, enjoyed the show. I know you can't taste it right now, but I hope you enjoyed it. I want you guys to know that you are very special, important people in my lives, and I love you guys dearly, and I can't wait to see you again soon, but I hope you guys give this a shot and like it, And for the rest of the audience, if you guys like this, please go ahead and hit subscribe and notifications and check this recipe out. It's a darn good one. Good way to start a party too. All right, thanks everybody. Okay, quick addendum. I realized that we have consistently skipped that part of the cooking show where people come and taste the food and lose their minds, fingers crossed. So let's bring in a tasting crew. Finn, that's for you. Dylan, go two-handed.
It's okay.
Kelly wants to be off camera. All right, what do you think?
Really good.
Yeah, I do.
Is that
really
good? It's good.
Penny, really good or amazing?
And ladies and gentlemen, that's why I do all those words.
Real good.
Thanks, everybody.